Hello, I'm Johnny Cash. I hear the train a-coming, it's rolling around a bend, and I ain't seen the sunshine since I don't know when. I'm stuck in Folsom Prison, and time keeps dragging on. But that train keeps a-rolling on down to San Antone. When I was just a baby, my mama told me, son, always be a good boy, don't ever play with guns. But I shot a man in Reno just to watch him die. When I hear that whistle blowing, I hang my head and cry. Bet there's rich folks eating from a fancy dining car. They're probably drinking coffee and smoking big cigars. Well, I know I had it coming. I know I can't be free. But those people keep a moving, and that's what tortures me. If they freed me from this prison, if that railroad train was mine, I bet I'd move it on a little farther down the line. Far from Folsom Prison, that's where I want to stay. And I'd let that lonesome whistle blow my blues away.
A little down.
I said you sound a little down.
I'm like right now. I just did a podcast episode with my brother and his dad, and then I was doing something for Chepe. You remember Chepe, right?
Yeah.
Chepe called, so I'm putting something together for him right now. And you know, just staying busy though. You know, staying busy. Yep. That kind of thing.
Yeah.
But how are you doing?
I had emailed you two times
today.
That's why I called, because I'm like, must be pretty busy or something.
No, you know what? I didn't get a message. I'll let me check my phone. Let me check my phone on account of because what it does is it'll give me a notification. It'll tell me when I have something coming, and
yeah. I know you had got my one with that poem on there. I'm like, I know it get him.
Yeah, so I posted that too.
What's going on?
I posted that. I posted that.
Yeah. No. I'm a. You know, it's things going on here you don't know about that. I'm just going to let ride. When you mentioned Chepe, I was just like, okay.
Well,
what?
Tell me, what are you talking about? Like, what do you mean by things going on? Like, does it concern me? Is it like, you know what I mean? It's like, is it?
No, it's not concerning you. It's okay. Just things in here. You know, we know what the words say about man and woman. You know what I mean?
Okay. You just told me right there. You just told me a whole earload. Yeah. And but I knew that, but you know what, like
that's your, you know what I mean, your word is your word, so you know, whatever you're doing, you know, you're doing that from the heart, so whatever.
Yeah, you know, like, even though, like, he's in that sin, you know, and I don't want to sound like most, like, you got Christians that be like, you know, I can't judge him, man, you know. I'm not going to judge him.
Right.
But, like, you know, I'm just trying to help him out. And
Right.
And because of that, you know, like, I knew that when I was there, you know, like, yeah. I knew that when I was there because of, because other people that he was in the cell with, and then that's really why I got out the cell with him, because I just noticed that he was. Well, granted, we bumped heads, but I knew after the fact I got in the cell with him, and then it was like, I gotta go, man. I can't.
It's one of those things. I was trying to speak, like, you know, we were. When he first came, we was roomies for a minute, and I was trying to give him the word, and it wasn't no hard thing. It was just that he couldn't deal with the fact that I was an active person, and, you know what I mean? So that wasn't no issue, but a lot of things have come to light, you know what I mean? Which was really, that wasn't the reason. This other issue was the reason, so.
Yeah. Well.
But anyway, what you got? You said you was doing a lot of, you had your podcast going and then helping with your father doing something or something?
Yeah, my brother's dad and I and my brother, we did a podcast episode. It was just some silly stuff. It's like, you know, like I would love to be able to do a podcast episode too. I'm going to tell you what, dude, check this out. This is what the Lord did yesterday, and it progressed into today. I had these three Jehovah Witnesses come knock on my door yesterday, and they're Spanish.
Wow.
They're, you know,
they still do that.
And yeah, well, because, you know, in Acts, they follow Acts, where it talks about going from door to door, from house to house, how the church and its Genesis would do so. So they had knocked on my door. It was these three Spanish-speaking women. And mi español es solo poquito, okay? So my Spanish is very little. But I have on my phone an app that allows me to translate only to a degree.
What they say.
Well, you know, they wouldn't budge. You know, I said John 1:1. Look, for me, John 20:28. When Thomas says, "My Lord and my God," and when you look at Jesus, I know how your approach is, all right? But I'm just saying how when Thomas says to Jesus, "My Lord and my God," that's the best one. I'm gonna tell you my opinion. It's the best one, Danny, and I'm not trying to one up you. It's the best one because in the New Living Translation, out of all the verses that I could use the word corrupt, right? But let's just say have fudged, messed up, whatever, twisted to fit their doctrine. That's the one verse, Danny, that they have not tampered with, and they keep it capital. They don't do little G or a little L for Lord. So anyhow, when I talk to these three ladies, Danny, just bear with me. Go ahead. All right, you go ahead.
It's interesting that you mentioned that. Do you remember, was Westside here when you was here?
Yeah, I talked to him. Well, I do, but that's because he's a Muslim. Right.
Yeah, okay. So on Christmas, you know, I'm like, I don't care if you Muslim, whatever you are, I'm going to say Merry Christmas today. You know what I mean? He was like,
all calls other than properly placed attorney calls may be monitored and recorded.
Nevertheless, sorry to hear that, but you have a merry one. You have a merry Christmas. And so he said, something about, I know who I serve. I said, I know exactly who you serve. You serve whoever Watchtower tells you to serve. But anyway, the Lord thy God is Savior. And he said, only man call him God. And then he referred back to that scripture to Thomas. Only Thomas called him that. I said, but is only God supposed to receive worship? Because he never denied people to worship him. Every time somebody worshiped him, he never told them get up like angels did. He never told them get up like John did. He was like, he received all worship because he's the only one that ought to be worshipped. And then by then he was walking out the bathroom angrily. But yeah, he brought that science scripture up. That's it, just, you know what I mean?
Yeah. And you know what?
Yeah, mentioned that scripture, and he tried to defend it with saying that that was man calling him that.
You know what? That's what
even though I could have took him to many, many other verses where, you know what I mean? When the Jews wanted to stone him, they wanted to stone him for only one reason. He was making himself equal with God. Leviticus told him that's what they ought to do. So, yeah. It's interesting. It would just surprise me that you said the Jehovah's Witness came to you. That you brought that topic up, and I had that conversation, like, on Christmas. You know what I mean? A few days ago.
Oh, you talking about that West Side. But, yeah, you talking about Ricky, yeah. I thought you were talking about West Coast, my bad.
Yeah, Ricky, yep.
When you said West Tower, like, I thought so check this out. And see, another thing, let's say, okay, like, just between you and I conversing, like, for instance, like, what I said to the women, though, and then because a guy came here today from them, and I was like, yeah, come on over, I'll be here. And I brought up that same verse, but then, you know, I told him, I said, look, I said, okay, I said, Jesus is sinless, right? And he said, yeah. I said, look. If I call you God, if I call you my Lord and my God, would I be sinning? And he's like, yeah, because, you know, you can't call something created God and you can't call him Lord. That is a sin against God. I said, okay. If I call you my Lord and my God and you allow me to.
Right.
Would that not make you a sinner? He knew where I was getting with this, and that would be, yeah.
Right.
So then by doing so, then that would make Christ a sinner, right? But then he tried to say something about that. I said, look, I said, Jesus fulfilled the law perfectly, correct? And he said, yeah. I said, okay. So what does this say in the law? You shall have no other gods before me. And that's the stuff I would tell Rick when I was in there also, just like just like the other guy that had the issue with his eye, the tall guy that was bald. I can't remember his name neither. I can't remember his name, but these are the things.
I remember you talking about.
These are the, when I was there and I would witness to Jehovah's Witnesses, these were the things that I would speak about. Now, granted, it didn't happen overnight. You know, it was like, you know, searching and coming across it. And then just, you know, contemplating and then saying to myself, wait a minute. That's like, but then, like, I don't know your stance on this. There's like other stuff that I've pondered. Like when I hear a Christian believe in extraterrestrials and aliens, I'm like,
wow,
that doesn't fit in with God's word. There you got believers out there. They believe in aliens. I tell them my perspective that it's a demonic deception, you know?
Right.
And yet their approach is, well, maybe there's a Jesus for them. And then that's when I say, wait a minute. And I might quote, like, where it says God has made man.
What did you say? There's a what for God?
Who, me? Are you talking about me?
Yeah, yeah. What'd you say? They said it was a what for God?
Oh, they'll say this. You'll have people and they'll say, well, because this is what I'll say. I'll say, and I know what you're talking about, but before that, I'll say, okay, well, if there's extraterrestrials, then they must be perfect, right? I said they must be perfect. In other words, they must be sinless. That's what I'm getting at. They must be sinless.
Right.
They don't need a savior.
Right.
And now if they say, yeah, I say, well, wait a minute. You have people saying that they've been abducted and that there's been experiments conducted on them against their will. That would make them a sinner, right? So then what ends up opening the door, they'll say, well, maybe God gave them, maybe they have their own Jesus. Maybe God's given them their own savior as well. Then that's when I quote in, I think it's in Psalms 8, where it talks about that God has made man a little lower than the angels, but crowned him with righteousness and glory. And you know the verse better than I.
Yeah.
And I'm like, wait a minute. God's plan for redemption was saving man, solo man, it says in God's word. But also, then I might break into, like, get into, like, without going to a direct verse, but saying, you know, God became a man to redeem man. Because only God could, because only God could do so on account of God's perfection, God's sinless perfection. He provided the ultimate sacrifice. And then I could be melodramatic and be like, you know, God provided the last the first sacrifice for sin, which was Adam and Eve, and the last sacrifice for sin, which was with Jesus, God as a man, God as man. And but when a Jehovah's Witness came here today and we were talking, you know, I didn't want to come across puff-minded, you know. I didn't want to come across as so. I also wanted to come across down to earth, because when he came in here, he came into this makeshift studio that I have in my living room. And in my living room, it's kind of like a joke. I got like some planets that I made by hand, and I made this flying saucer. Because when me and my brother and his dad we'll talk about all kinds of kooky. Look, these aren't my brother and his dad.
Things that you did as a kid and stuff, right?
Well, yeah, but I these are things that I made now because it's for the podcast. On account of the podcast, we talk about a series of topics. We might talk about transgenderism in society today. We look at it from I look at it from a biblical perspective. They look at it from their perspective. Now, granted, they'll look at it from a conservative perspective, which is, leaning, but even if somebody were to be in here and they're liberal, I'm going to stand by my biblical worldview, right? What they say, they say. But see, by doing so, let's say if I were to have somebody on this show that was liberal, it would manifest it would provoke thought to where it's thought provoking. It's like, okay, wait a minute, this makes sense. There's got to be there can't be two people can't be right, which is I'm opening the door for what then? Absolute truth.
Right.
Only one can be absolutely right. And then
all calls other than properly placed attorney calls may be monitored and recorded.
When a Jehovah Witness came here again today, the man's name is Paul. And I cracked a joke about that. I said, Apostle Paul. But when I said it in a way that wasn't demeaning. I wanted him to come back. I said, look, this is when I get off of work, come back. Well, I told him, I said, dude, we could do a podcast. We could end up. And I said, look, we don't have to, not debate. You just say your side, I say my side, and we leave it for the viewers to decide.
Right.
But
I doubt they come back.
Well, the guy actually.
That first question be like, is this. Who do you say Jesus is? And that will shake them to their core right there, because they can only say what they book say. You know what I mean?
Yeah, but see, now that's where you use their book.
They can never say what the actual Bible says. You know what I mean?
Hold on. Think of who Doc Doc is, right? Remember, he's got the ministry on Channel 30. Doc Doc is the one Doc Doc is the man who translated the Quran into English. He's got it. He's got his Christian ministry. He witnesses to the Muslim. Here's the thing. This is something that I gathered from Doc Doc, because he said it out of his own mouth. He said, he had Christian pastors, right? Americanized pastors. And they're like, well, we're going to get together and we're going to burn a bunch of Qurans and come together. Come with us, Doc Doc. We're going to do a Quran burning. And he said, no, what are you doing? No, you don't want to do that. And they're puzzled by his answer. What do you mean, no? They're thinking, let's get rid of these books. They're bad. He said, for one, you're going to buy books. You're going to give them money. They're going to publish more books. He said, look, the way to do it is you. And when I say this, I mean it in the polite sense, but from the constructive approach, he said, you use their own book against them. In other words, look, you don't burn the Quran, you expose the Quran.
Right.
You burning the Quran solves nothing, but by you showing the contradictions, which he does, I don't know if you know this, but you could write to Doc Doc will send you a free. Now, granted, you might say, well, I got God's word. I don't need nothing else, Rich. I'll tell you what, when I was in there, I wrote to Doc Doc. Doc Doc gave me a free He gave me a 3-part series. What it was his version of the Quran. Which is the unadulterated version of the Quran, not the stuff that you got these guys in here having, in which they don't realize that the only sure way to Allah is
the
by
Americanized version,
the Westernized version.
Yeah, Westernized. Yeah,
I get what you're saying, Americanized. But when you look at it from the West perspective, they have a diluted version of,
because if it was so, all you have to do is look to PBS and see how the actual Muslims are treating their people, and it's not the love or and peace and all those things that they profess.
I'll tell you what, you know Sharif, right? Now you know Sharif. When I would talk to Sharif, what Sharif does is this, and he knows what he's doing. And I told him this is what he does. Now I don't talk like how I talk like when I'm talking to you now, because when I was in there, I was all broke. I'm like, oh my gosh, broken in terms of spirit and whatnot, you know. But I would still
1 minute times remaining.
I had conversations with him. Ultimately, this is what I said. I said, look, because he'll talk to Christians, right, and then he'll befriend them, right. But the Quran is against that. It's Surah like 551 or something. And I'd say, look, you know, the Quran even says that. Not to take Jews and Christians as friends and all that. Now, I'm not trying to teach hate, but what I was saying is, see, he would do it in a subductive way, in a subtle way, like the kind of, you know. Let's pray real quick. Let's just pray. You lead off, brother.
Well, he ought to be, and as far as the Quran, he ought to be killing. He ought to be killing us if we're
infidels. Lead off. Let's get a quick prayer in.
Converting to Islam.
Danny, let's get a quick prayer in. Lead off.
Go ahead.
All right. Well, God the Father, in Jesus' name, we come to you in prayer. We ask, God the Father, that you would bless Danny with somebody who's going to be able to hear him, that's going to hear this podcast, God the Father, and is going to be that stone for him, for his Goliath, to get him back to his daughter and his grandchildren. I know you have at least one. His grandchild, if not grandchildren, God the Father. May you seek to be glorified in this, and may you get glory out of this, God the Father. In Jesus' name we ask, and we both say amen.